Now, he begins by mentioning the poor, and I think it is a mistake to not see the most obvious understanding right out of the gate, and certainly what his audience would understand when he said it. The poor means you have no money. It is an economic term. We don't just spiritualize this away. He is talking to those who are poor. Again, no money, so no status, no power, no privilege in society. Poor may be a relative term depending on the country and the time. But he's not just talking about economics either. It's definitely broader than this. And he's also not saying that there is a special blessing just because you have no money. Maybe you're a fool who has squandered all your money and that's why you don't have any. No, what he is talking about, and it becomes clearer as we go on, the one who is poor, yes, but is trusting in the Lord. I am trusting in the Lord because he's all I have. I can't trust in the power or the prestige or the class that I have because I don't have any. I don't have any powerful friends that'll help me out. I got to trust in the Lord. Now, what follows? Because there's a sequence here. What follows poverty? How is poverty best seen worldwide throughout history? If someone is really poor, they're hungry. Again, they have no food. They have trouble feeding their family. When Jesus told us to pray, "Give us this day our daily bread." Maybe many of us in this country just cannot relate to that because we have the question at night, what are we going to eat? Whereas many around the world are saying, are we going to eat tonight? But Jesus was being pretty literal there. Give us this day our daily bread. If you are poor, typically you are hungry. Your children are hungry. And you are relying on the Lord. You're the sort of person who is trusting him. But you know what else follows that sort of poverty that leads to hunger? A lot of tears. A lot of weeping, doesn't it? How many parents cry themselves to sleep at night because their children have to go to bed hungry? And they just can't do anything about it. Mommy, Daddy, I'm hungry. I'm sorry, there's no food. Poor, hunger now, weep now. But again, to show that it's not simply a situation of economics that just a bunch of rich millionaires could solve, he then goes on to say, when you're reviled, rejected, cast out for my sake, the Son of Man, Jesus. Well, that puts a different look on it, doesn't it? He says, then you're basically receiving what the prophets of God have always received. If we proclaim the truth as Jesus proclaimed it himself. In other words, we're quoting him. We're not making it up. We're saying what he said. We're telling people that no matter how sincere their religious beliefs are, if they're not founded in Christ as Savior, as the one, the God incarnate who came to earth to die on the cross for their sins and rise from the dead, if they're not believing that, that their beliefs are lies, that they're wrong, how many friends are you going to win and how many people are you going to influence if that's your campaign slogan, for example, right? But that's the truth. That's what Jesus said. No one comes to the Father except through me. Well, I believe all religions lead to God. Well, you can believe whatever you want, and certainly no one is seeking to enforce by force a religious belief on someone else. But just because you believe that all religions lead to God doesn't make it true. A lot of football fans believe that their team would be in the Super Bowl this year. Chargers! Chargers! And yet, next week when they play the game, there's only two teams that are going to be there, huh? You can believe that stuff in September. Then when the game gets played, you realize you're wrong. Well, you can believe what you want while you're walking this earth. But when you die, you find out how wrong you are if your beliefs are not found in Jesus Christ. And to say that, again, for the Son of Man's sake, you're cast out. No one's casting you out because you're a jerk, but because you stand on the truth. And that's where Jesus is preparing his followers in the transition. This is the transition, my followers. You're going to have to pick up your own cross and follow me. You are not to expect earthly prosperity and blessing if you're a follower of Jesus Christ. You're actually going to be cast out. People are not going to want to do business with you because you're a Christian. Again, in America, we may not be able to understand that, but that has been history throughout the centuries. The early Christian church locked out of a lot of just financial transactions and dealing because the pagans didn't want to deal with the Christians. Who are you going to sell your goods to? Who are you going to buy goods to? Is my money no good? No, we don't want your money. Not if you're a Christian. We don't want that dirty Christian money. It's going to get lonely. But when that happens, rejoice and leap for joy. It's like what God's true prophets have experienced over the years. And so therefore the clear contrast with the woes. You're rich, you're full, you're laughing, and again, this is why the context of this thing is so important, because someone says, woe to those who laugh now, and you feel guilty about laughing and having a good time in life? No, he's talking about the type of person who is rich, who is partying, who is celebrating, laughing it up, has no cares on this earth. Because that's going to change. How many times when Jesus spoke about hell did he say there'd be weeping and gnashing of teeth? And then the person who says, oh, we can all get along and believe, and really the only intolerant ones are those Bible-believing Christians out there. Well, then you're talking like a false prophet, and everyone will listen to you because everyone wants to hear that. But woe to you when all men speak well of you. Now, two groups. But I want you to see this as we close, and this is what I hope you all take away with you today. The blessing is in the present. Blessed are you who hunger now. You're blessed now. The blessing is in the present, in the moment, but it is grounded in a future hope, isn't it? Blessed are you now because one day you'll be filled. One day, instead of weeping, you will laugh because yours is the kingdom of God. The promise is not that, hey, you'll be filled next week if you just have enough faith. And no, there's no promise like that at all, no matter what you see on TV from time to time. That's not what Jesus said. Life as a Christian may be hard from beginning to end, but you're blessed in the middle of it. It's a transition. It's a mental change, because the Jew's thinking, wait a minute, we're supposed to be blessed by being financially prosperous and all. No. That's not what the cross is about. That's not what to expect. That's not what to expect in this life. As a follower of Jesus Christ, don't expect the material blessings in this life. Expect the hardship. And again, it's not that there's a virtue in just being poor. The virtue is your attitude towards God in the midst of it. And that attitude is shown by the fact that you stand for the truth and that others revile you for it, as one of those intolerant Bible thumpers. Let's pray.